So I looked back in the archives on the website. It was actually a little over 3 years ago that we started studying the book of John verse by verse. So obviously we have not been in a race. Slow and steady, right? One of the reasons is we only have one meeting a week, and we try to have a verse-by-verse lesson and then something topical, or if somebody has a question or a current event that needs dealt with. But 3 years. So the next book that I teach will probably be a shorter one. Think in Philemon or Jude, something like that. One of those one-chapter guys. That should only take a few months, right? But the last time we closed out chapter 20, this week we're going to do all of chapter 21. Chapter 21 is often considered to be an addendum, but I would say that God's Holy Spirit inspired every word for us exactly as we should have it. And the last couple of verses in John 20 was a verse we've looked at many times, and many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing ye might have life through his name. So John's declaring, I did not write an exhaustive account of everything Jesus did, but I wrote these specific ones so his readers would believe that Jesus was the prophesied Christ, was Israel's prophesied Messiah. And you read that and it sounds like there should be an amen. So John must have been a good preacher, because it looks like the book's done and he's going to go on for a whole nother chapter. It's like when the preacher says, finally, you know he's got 10 more minutes in him. So let's look at the beginning of chapter 21. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias, and on this wise showed he himself. So the third time Jesus is appearing to his disciples after his resurrection. We saw the first two in the last chapter of John. And you remember when Jesus seemed like he was just teleporting into the room, appearing. They had the doors closed. But people like to go bonkers over numbers. They like to go, you know, numbers are significant in your Bible. Number 3, number 12, number 40, number 8. There's significance in the Bible, but people like to take numbers and go off the deep end with it and get into numerology. I've seen people where if you go to the ancient Hebrew Torah and count the first letter of every third word, it spells out 9/11, you know, or something like that. They kind of go nuts with numbers. But there are lots of significant number threes in your Bible. Think about the Godhead, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Think about the way we are set up, spirit, soul, and body. We're a three-part being. Jesus rose from the dead on the third day. Plant life appeared on planet Earth by God's creation on the third day. There's lots of threes, but if we're going to look at threes prophetically in its context, which is how we study the book of John, we don't come to it and rip out slogans. We don't come to it and steal Israel's mail and make it our own. We look at the threes, and you could look over at Luke 13. Do you remember the parable of the fig tree, anyone? In Luke 13, not the one that Jesus cursed, but over in Luke 13:6, he spake also this parable: a certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came and sought fruit thereon, and found none. Then said he unto the dresser of his vineyard, behold, these 3 years I come seeking fruit on this fig tree, and find none. Cut it down. Why cumbereth it the ground? I love that language. It's a waste of dirt. Why cumbereth it the ground? But how long did Jesus minister to Israel? 3 years. The fig tree, the vineyard, that's always associated with Israel. But look what comes next. And he answering said unto him, Lord, let it alone this year also, giving the fig tree, giving the vineyard another year, till I shall dig about it and dung it, And if it bear fruit, well, and if not, then after that thou shalt cut it down. What happens after Christ raises and ascends back into heaven? We have God's Holy Spirit pouring out on the little flock of Israel, right? And they go minister the truth of the Messiah's resurrection for about another year before God ushers in the dispensation of grace, right? So prophetically, looking at that three, and wow, they got 3 years, and they got another year after that. Because we know the prophetic timeline from Daniel's 70 weeks, right? Messiah's cut off at 69. What comes after 69? 70. And Peter stands up at Pentecost and says, hey guys, the 70th week is here. Everything that Joel talked about, it's happening right now. So you see the prophetic timeline is continuing to march on in the early part of the book of Acts. And obviously we know God interrupted that program, brought in the mystery dispensation of grace. But I would submit to you that's a fairly good explanation for the significance of the three, but also a couple of other verses that I always used to wonder about. When you know that when Daniel had that vision, and he had that vision of weeks of years, there's only a certain amount of time left in Israel's program, right? 490, right?
Daniel 9.
But remember what Jesus said in Matthew 24 when he's talking about, except those days should be shortened, there should no flesh be saved. Now, if you have a timeline clock that Daniel says, hey, it's going to be 490, it's got to be 490 or you've got a lie in your Bible, right? So how can those days be shortened? You can't cut a year off because then Daniel would be wrong. But the only way those days could be shortened is if God allows about a year to tick off the clock, ushers in a new dispensation, and then when the clock restarts, there's only about six left on the time frame till the end of day. So that, I can't be dogmatic about that. I can't prove that 100%, but that seems to me to make sense for an answer on how can those days be shortened and Daniel still be right. The other one, you remember when Peter asked Jesus, how many times should I forgive my brother? He says, seven times. And Jesus says, no, 70 times seven. I always wondered about that. Why would he pick 490? You know, did he just pull it out of a hat? 490, 760, you know. Was there any significance? Well, if you look at Israel's prophetic program, and Daniel said 490, that would be a pretty sound cross-reference to Jesus saying, hey, until 490, you forgive, with their prophetic program. Is that communicating at all? Mm-hmm. Okay. And that makes sense with what Daniel said. I'll just read Daniel 9:24. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to what? To finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, and to make reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness. So in a sense, you have the God-man Jesus saying, I'm forgiving till 490. Peter, you're commanded to forgive till 490 as well. So, like I said, I can't prove that 100%, but that seems to me, you know, in my shelf, we all have question marks in our Bible shelf, right? Verses we don't understand, doctrines we're not sure about. I put that in the maybe section on my answered questions shelf. Okay, so let's get back to the verses and we'll finish this book. Remember, Jesus showed himself numerous times. This is the third time recorded in John, but in Luke 2, not Luke chapter 2, but Acts. Acts is the second book written by Luke to the most excellent Theophilus. That's why some people call it Luke 2. But Acts 1:1, Luke says in verse 3, to whom he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. So Jesus is alive, walking around planet Earth, appearing to his disciples, talking with them, teaching them for 40 days, before he resurrects. And that is the context that we find here in the last chapter of the book of John. So, after his resurrection, before his ascension. Right. So they don't have the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost has not come upon them yet. They had their Jesus had a bad day. Oh no, our Messiah, our King is dead. We didn't see this coming. Now he's back to life, so they're kind of in this in-between time frame where they're waiting. And Peter finds a way to keep himself busy here in the top of the chapter. There, in John 21:2, there were together Simon Peter and Thomas called Didymus and Nathanael of Cana in Galilee and the sons of Zebedee and two other of his disciples. Simon Peter saith unto them, I go a fishing. They say unto him, we also go with thee. They went forth and entered into a ship immediately, and that night they caught nothing. But when morning was now come, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples knew not that it was Jesus. That's something I never say. I go a fishing. I don't fish. I remember the day I came out to my father-in-law. I finally was able to be honest with him and say, Jerry, I don't like fishing. Broke the man's heart, but he's decided to love me anyway. But I don't get it. You go out there, you play with some stinky, slimy things, poke yourself in the finger, bleed a little, sit there bored for hours, and the payoff is to pull another stinky, slimy, flippy thing out of the water. I don't get it. It's not me. I mean, I know Linda loves to fish, so she'll probably be mortified, but I just never say that. That's not really good Bible exegesis. That's just my thoughts. But Peter goes fishing, and Jesus saith that. So Jesus comes to the shore. I don't know how far they are out, but they don't know it's Jesus yet. They see a figure out by the shore. And Jesus saith unto them, children, have ye any meat? They answered him, no. And he said unto them, cast the net on the right side of the ship, and ye shall find. So they actually listened to this guy yelling from the shore, throw it on the right side of the ship. Why? I don't know. They were the pros, but they decided maybe because it had been such a bad night, they hadn't caught anything. Let's throw it out the other side and see what we get. They cast therefore, and now they were not able to draw it for the multitude of fishes. So that also proves something I've been arguing with my brother about for most of my life. There is a right side and there is a wrong side. My brother is wrong-handed. And I've been telling him this his whole life. He's a wrong-hander. He can be right-handed or wrong-handed. So obviously, this text teaches that. The right side is the proper side. Now that's silly. Why do I say that's silly? Because how many of you have listened to a sermon where somebody comes to John 21, reads this, and starts telling spiritualized tales about you have to do it Jesus way. You try to do it your way. And this is what Jesus is trying to teach us here. You've done it your way, but now you need to listen to the master and do it the right way. On and on. And you can tell, I have a sermon book of sermon illustrations that's this thick that has thousands of things like that. You think preachers just make it up? On Saturday night, they pull their book out. Let's see what original thought I will have tomorrow morning. And everybody will be amazed. That's how it works. But yes, spiritually, we can learn from that. Is it good to obey the Lord Jesus Christ's commands? Obviously, yes. We can learn that spiritual truth. And we should take that to heart, too, and remember what our Apostle Paul says, that says, if any man think himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge that the commandments that I write are the commandments of the Lord. People don't like it when we talk like that. Why, you follow Paul, I follow Jesus. If you're not following Paul, you're not following Jesus today in the dispensation of God's grace. I copied and pasted one of these spiritualized tales from John 21. This is from a devotional that you can spend money on. Why does John include this detail? Are you working on the right side of your personal boat? Are you more apt to make minor or major adjustments in your life? The disciples, they switched their nets all the way to the other side of the boat. They listened to somebody who they didn't even know who it was. Why did the disciples take instruction from a person who to them was merely an unproven armchair quarterback? That's what you get in church from this passage. Now, that's great, but you know what that is? That is stuff, conversation starters. Small group conversation starters to get the people who like to hear their own voice start talking and fill up the time, right? Is that Bible study? Or is that, let's hear everybody's opinions on how they feel? That's not Bible study, so that's why I won't be telling any of those stories tonight. We're just going to study the verses. What? Too late? I was just reading somebody else's story. But seriously, that's not Bible study. That's not spiritual growth. But that passes off and everybody leaves and says, church was wonderful. What did you learn? I learned my own opinion. And I learned Bob's opinion. Okay. Let's do some Bible study. Being that we are in, here in John, we are in the prophetic program, I'm going to go way out on a limb and say, there may be some prophetic undertones to what's going on here. That's what I want to look at. We already know Jesus told them, follow me, I'm going to make you fishers of men, right? So that analogy has already been used, fishing. But when you, the other thing is you find the disciples working through the night. And there is some significance to that. And then you have the Lord show up. They didn't know he was going to show up. They didn't know when, but he did. And you'll see as they come here, the Lord invites them to come eat with him on the shore. Is there anything prophetic to tie into that? That's what we're going to look at. I should have told you to stay in Luke. Look over at Luke 6. Luke 6, 32. I've got the wrong reference there. It's not Luke 6, 32. Fear not, little flock, it's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Anyway, this is in the Bible somewhere. I've just mistyped the reference. That's how you know this is inspired, right? I'll wake up in the middle of the night tonight and be like, why couldn't you remember that reference? It's right there in your brain. Somewhere in your Bible, Jesus says in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell that ye have and give alms, provide for yourselves bags which wax not old. Didn't the disciples do that? They obeyed. They got rid of their stuff. A treasure in the heavens that faileth not, where no thief approacheth, neither moth corrupteth. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Let your loins be girded about and your lights burning. Remember that. Girding your loins and lights burning. When do we burn lights? At night, right? And ye yourselves like unto men that wait for their Lord when he will return from the wedding, that when he cometh and knocketh, they may open unto him immediately. Blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. Verily I say unto you that he shall gird himself and make them to sit down to meat and will come forth and serve them. And if he shall come in on the second watch or come in on the third watch and find them so, blessed are those servants. 12? How did I get a 6 out of that? Luke 12:32. Well, at least we know now for sure that it's in the Bible, and you don't have to trust my word for it. But you see this, what Jesus talking about, these guys being ready and working through the night and waiting on the appearance of their Lord. That's a sign of the tribulation. Remember, they have to endure to the end. They have to stay steadfast until the end, and they get their salvation. Remember what Peter says? When the Lord comes back, when their salvation draws nigh. So what happens next in John? John 21:7. Therefore that disciple whom Jesus loved saith unto Peter, it is the Lord. So the stranger on the shore says, cast him on the right side. And whoa, we got all the fishes in there. And John says, that's the Lord. Now when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he girt his fisher coat unto him, for he was naked, and did cast himself into the sea. So once again, old Pete. Pete's all in, whatever he's doing, right? You give me a sword, I'm going to chop a guy's head off with it. I'm going night fishing? No, I'm going naked night fishing. All in, right? I don't know why he was naked night fishing. We will have to ask him one day. But there he is. But what does he do when he finds out it's the Lord? He girts himself, right? Gets ready. And then, just like Forrest Gump, when he found out Mama was sick, Pete dives out of the boat and swims for shore. So you gotta love this guy. He's just all in. He girts himself and just jumps right in. And the other disciples, verse 8, came in a little ship, for they were not far from land, but as it were 200 cubits, dragging the net with the fishes. As soon as they were come to land, they saw a fire of coals there, and fish laid thereon, and bread. And Jesus saith unto him, bring of the fish which ye have now caught. Simon Peter went up and drew the net to land, full of great fishes, 153, for all there were so many, yet was not the net broken. And what's Jesus do next? Come and dine. And he serves them and feeds them. And none of the disciples durst ask him, who art thou, knowing that it was the Lord? Jesus then cometh and taketh bread and giveth them, and fish likewise. This is now the third time that Jesus showed himself to his disciples. After that, he was risen from the dead. So think about it. The Lord shows up. The disciples have a great harvest of fish that they bring in to the Lord when he shows up. Think the parable of the sower, right? The last sowing, they reap and hunt, you know, some tenfold, some 60-fold, some 100-fold, and bring it to the Lord, and they enter in to that kingdom with their harvest. And the Lord is serving them, just like what's prophesied. I would submit to you that is a better, you know, as sloppily as I just presented that, I would submit to you that that's better than telling stories about the right side of the boat. As far as why is this story, why is this account in there? I see that as a type of what these men are about to be commissioned to do. It's a type of the kingdom, but it's not the kingdom. Yes?
They were about to eat the best meal ever cooked by the best chef ever.
This is true. The creator of all things would know how to cook properly.
Absolutely. never a dinner that to dine was any better.
Nice. But how do I know it's not the kingdom? The reason I say that is many people in Reformed theological circles will say, those prophecies about the kingdom, those aren't literal. Those are allegories. The kingdom is now, and it's a spiritual thing, and all that stuff in Revelation, that's just allegory. It's not real. It's not literal. You know, you are the kingdom. You've heard people pray when they pray their prayers. They pray for the furtherance of the kingdom, right? They think that the kingdom is now. Where if we as Bible believers can come look at this and say, that's not the kingdom. That's Jesus on the seashore feeding his disciples. It's a type of the kingdom, and you can see these prophetic tie-ins, but it's not the literal kingdom. How do we know that? Because we can read Matthew. We read Matthew 25, when the Son of Man shall come in the throne of his glory. How do we know that this is not the kingdom? Because he doesn't have all nations gathered to him. He's not separating sheep and goats and sending some into hell and letting some into the kingdom. That's how we know it's not the kingdom, if you want to be a literal Bible believer. All right, a picture, a type. And you have literally people literally walking into the kingdom. That's not happening there. That's disciples. Peter was naked a few minutes before. Now Peter's got some clothes on and he's in his wet robe eating fish. It's not the kingdom. But let's move on here. We'll finish all this up. It's got to. There's got to be some reason behind the 153. I don't know it. But I honestly, the more I study the Bible, I don't think there's a wasted syllable. I think the only problem is we haven't yet figured it out. But God's got significance in everything. So, yeah, I did look at that, and I started to go investigate, but then I remembered, people go bonkers with numbers, so I'll just let that one lie. let's see. Okay, so the next three verses, this is where I really wish I had my whiteboard, so I'm going to try to imaginary draw. Maybe you can imagine I'm drawing things on a whiteboard. The next three verses are ground zero for people who will try to talk you out of believing your Bible as it stands. Has anybody ever heard of agapeo phileo? Agapeo phileo? Yeah. Have you heard a lesson taught on agape versus phileo? Right, okay. That's what we're going to talk about. Because, let's just read the verses here. 21:15. So when they had dined, Jesus saith to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my lambs. He saith unto him the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my sheep. 17, he saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved, because he said unto him the third time, Lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things, thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus said unto him, Feed my sheep. Now, the people who will take you to the original Greek, first of all, they're either lying or they're ignorant. There's no such thing as the original Greek. There are no original manuscripts. Greek was the original language that these books were written in, but there are no originals anywhere. We have nothing but copies of copies of copies, and God's okay with that. When Christ sat down in the temple and read the scroll from Isaiah, he didn't say, "What an unfortunate rendering." He read the scroll, which was a copy of a copy of a copy of a copy of a copy, and it was God's words. So, the theory is that there are three Greek words for love. Our English cannot capture the full meaning of the three Greek words for love. Therefore, your English Bible is inferior to the original language Greek. And if you really want to understand your Bible, you need to either sit at the feet of the man who can teach you Greek or become a Greek scholar yourself. But at the end of the day, when they're done with you, all you know is my English Bible isn't good enough. It's not what God wanted me to have. That's the way this goes. You mentioned agapeo is the highest, purest form of love. That's how it's taught, is agapeo is the highest, best form of love. That's, you know, I die for you type of love. And phileo is the more brotherly love, the tenderly affectioned love. And that's a lower form of love. That's how it's taught. And before we go there, because what the people who will take you to here will set up is they'll set up, Jesus asked agape, once, agape twice, then he switched to phileo. But what does it say in our English Bible and in the Greek? It says Jesus asked him a third time. And Peter was grieved because he asked him three times. There's the significance of the number three, right? But what the Greek scholars won't tell you is they say two times one, one time another. But the English and the Greek both say three times. Just put that on the shelf. Remember that. I remember the first time I heard a lesson taught on this. I was attending a church that was pastored by a Ruckmanite pastor. And I know you've heard of Peter Ruckman, Dr. Ruckman. Has anybody else heard of Dr. Ruckman? He recently died last year, but he's a Baptist, I don't want to say violent, militant defender of the King James Bible. The pastor who was pastoring the church graduated his school, was one of his students. And I didn't know what a Ruckmanite was. I didn't know what a dispensational was. But all I knew is that Billy guy, he's a King James Bible believer. He wouldn't change one word. Well, the week came where the rich deacon asked for a turn to speak. And he opens up and he turns to John 21 here. And I have to tell you, you think I'm boring? This man was so boring, I don't think I will ever hear a presentation for the rest of my life that is more boring than how he spoke. If you look at verse 21, we see agapeo. People around me are starting to fall asleep. Meanwhile, I'm becoming riveted because I see this guy's attacking the English Bible in that guy's church. So I'm just, how's this going to end up, you know? But when he was done with his presentation, it's the same I've heard many times since. It's the English isn't good enough. You need to understand, you need to be able to have the Greek in order to understand what God really wanted to say to you. And how it's presented is Jesus looks at Peter and says, do you agape me? Do you have the highest form of love? The I die for you love. And Peter's answer is, Lord, I phileo you. Meaning Peter, Pete's got a case of the mully grubs. He's still remembering that whole denied him three times. And he's not willing to say that, no, I agape you, Lord. I just phileo you. Then Jesus turns and says, Pete, do you agape me? And the second time, Peter says, I phileo you, Lord. You know, he's still not willing to go there. And then the third time, Jesus switches and says, Pete, do you phileo me? And Pete turns around and says, yes, I phileo you. And you don't get that in English because you don't understand the Greek. And you don't see the richness and the texture of the language that you miss when you see this interplay between Jesus and Peter, and Peter's not willing. Stories on end. What did I just tell you, though, before we got on that? Third time, right? Three times Jesus asked him something. Three times. But what they present is two times agape, one times phileo. So now the math doesn't add up. But the question is, can God communicate what he wants to mankind from one language to another? That's the question. When Moses went in to Pharaoh, and you can read it in Exodus 10, and Moses spoke unto Pharaoh, let my people go, do you suppose he was speaking Greek? Do you suppose he walked into the high court of the Egyptian king and spoke Hebrew? No. He most likely was speaking Egyptian to the king of Egypt. But yet, we have recorded in Hebrew, let my people go. Does that mean the same thing? Did we miss the nuance of what Moses said in the Egyptian language? Because there isn't a proper word in the Egyptian language for this compared to the Hebrew language. Do you see the slippery slope you go down? And that is always, I see that in the textual critics and the scholars. They talk about, well, this language doesn't have a word to approximate this word in another language. Which is, of course, true. But do humans have different thoughts? Does a German human have a different thought about love than a British human? They may have different... yeah. In 1939 they did. Should have picked two different countries. But think about it. We all have the same thoughts, the same feelings. We are mankind. We have different languages to describe these things, but they are the same emotions, the same thoughts, the same feelings. Words are just a way to describe them. But yeah, the Greek scholar, at the end of the day, what they leave you with. Here you start of the day. I've always been inclined to be a Bible believer. I always just inclined to just believe my English Bible as it's written. I've got limited time. I'm supposed to be redeeming my time. Let's best study, preach, and teach what we know in our English Bible, right? But when they're done with you, now you're doing Greek word studies for the rest of your life, wondering about the nuances of agape and phileo and how Peter was feeling that day. Does that matter one whit to seeing souls saved and saints edified? Does that help you in any way? It's not a good use of time, but what do you do with the original language scholar when you come over to Revelation 9? What do we do here? Revelation 9 and verse 11. And they had a king over them. You remember when the scorpion beasts come out of the ground? They had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue hath his name Apollyon. Ah! What do we do now? Now we have two of the original languages to choose from. Which one is oldest and best? Is it Abaddon or Apollyon? What do we do? Those both the languages of the originals. Which one do we pick? Where's the nuance? How about their synonyms? There are two words in two different languages to describe the same creature, the angel of the bottomless pit. Whether it's Hebrew or Greek doesn't matter. It's the same being. Synonyms. I have on my bookshelf a book called a thesaurus. It's full of synonyms. Different words that are synonymous with the same thing. Different ways of describing a particular thought or a particular feeling. It's called the Highly Selective Thesaurus for the Extraordinarily Gifted. I bought it for myself. No, somebody gave it to me. This is what I want to try to present with this three verses and this agape phileo thing, is that these words are synonyms, and they are used as synonyms in our Bible, in English and Greek. And we'd be better to just stick with our English Bible, trust it, believe it, and move on, than fall down the trap of this agape phileo stuff. And by the way, that's not taught by idiots like me who are Bible believers. That's taught by people who hate Bible believers, that this agape phileo stuff is bunk. Okay, so it's not just me, it's people that oppose me. But yet, there are pastors standing in pulpits and small groups in their churches trying to sound smarter than everybody, make them think that I know so much more than you because I know a little Greek and I read it in my vines, and they're pushing people away from believing their English Bible with this stuff. Are you okay with synonyms? Everybody okay with synonyms? I don't know about you, but one day I'll get a text message from my wife that says, "Honey, I adore you." Ah, agapeo. And then the next day when she just says, "I love you," I freak out. What happened? What happened between Tuesday and Wednesday? Did I get in the phileo zone? What did I do, honey? No. It's two ways of saying the same thing. Agape phileo. In John 3:35, remember in John 3:35 when it said that the Father loves the Son? Now, of course the Father is going to be the agape, right? Yes, in John 3:35, it's the Father, agape, the Son, agapeo. But the same sentence two chapters later in John 5:20 says, the Father loves the Son, loveth the Son. And the word is what? It's got to be agapeo again, right? Because it's God. No, it's phileo. Two words, same sentence, same God, same Son. One's agape, one's phileo. Synonymous. Two ways of saying the same thing. What about those Pharisees? Those rotten generation of vipers. In Luke 11:43, the Pharisees love the uppermost seats, right? That can't be the highest love. The Pharisees agapeo the highest seats. Nine chapters later in Luke 20, the Pharisees phileo the uppermost seats. Same Pharisees, same uppermost seats. The two words are used interchangeably in the Greek and in the English. And in our English Bible, it's translated love, and I'm okay with that. Because if you let the terms be synonymous, then the math adds up. Jesus asked him one time. Jesus asked him the second time. Jesus asked him the third time, just as it's listed in John 21. But if we take the Greek scholars, which, by the way, I've only met one. Of all the scholars that I've met that talked about the Greek, or I've met one that could read a Greek New Testament sitting in front of them. Everybody else is getting something off the internet or Googling or stealing somebody else's work. I met one. But like I said, all I'm trying to do is point out we'd be better off to just believe the English words as we have them. The math adds up, and we can still redeem our time. Ephesians 5:16, we need to be redeeming the time in this present evil world. Does everybody understand that? We're good with that? May not agree, but the math adds up. One time, two times, three times. And why would the three be significant? Of course, because Peter denied him three times. And Jesus asked him three times, do you love me? Yes, but I'm grieved because I know what I've done. All right, so let's finish up the book and get out of here. John 21. Verse 18. So now Pete's going to get a prophecy that he's not too excited to hear. Verily, verily, I say unto thee, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself and walkest whither thou wouldest. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thy hands, and another shall gird thee and carry thee whither thou wouldest not. This spake he, signifying what death he should glorify God. And when he had thus spoken this, he saith unto him, follow me. Now, I can't prove beyond a shadow of a doubt that Jesus is saying, Pete, you're going to die by being crucified. But it sure looks like it's leaning that way. Somebody else, you're not going to be able to walk where you want to go. You're going to stretch forth your hands. Another person's going to take you someplace you don't want to go. And then, how many times did we see back in John, this spake he signifying what death he should die? And it was pointing to the cross. And then Jesus says right at the end, follow me. It seems to me that's a reasonable understanding. Having said that, you will read in all of your martyrs' books that that Peter was crucified upside down in Rome because he didn't feel worthy enough to be crucified right side up like his Lord. That you have exactly zero Bible to support. That is Roman Catholic tradition. You don't have any evidence out in your Bible. You actually have evidence seeming to point that Peter never went to Rome. But the only accounts you have of Peter being in Rome, getting crucified upside down, and his bones being there underneath the Pope's throne is from the Pope. So beware, Catholic tradition. You cannot support that with Bible. But just reading the verses, it seems to me Jesus is saying, hey, Pete, you're going to die the same way I did. Follow me! That's what it seems like. So let's finish up the book, the series, the study. Finally. Then Peter, turning about, seeing the disciple whom Jesus loved following. So it looks like this whole conversation with the agape phileo, it looks like Peter and Christ were walking alone. Which also leaned on his breast at supper and said, Lord, which is he that betrayeth thee? That guy, Peter, seeing him, saith to Jesus, Lord, what shall this man do? Hey, Lord, I think you just told me I'm going to die by crucifixion. How about this jerk? What job, what wonderful job does he get? I just phileoed you 3 times after I swam to shore like Forrest Gump and I get to die by crucifixion. How about John? What's he get? Jesus saith unto him, if I will that he tarry till I come, what is that to thee? Follow thou me. Seems like a mild rebuke there. If it's my will to let this guy live till I come back, what business is it of yours, Pete? Now, what this started was a rumor. You'll see here the rumor being explained and the rumor being disproven by the guy the rumor's about. Then went this saying abroad among the brethren that the disciple should not die, yet Jesus said, not unto him he shall not die, but if I will, he tarry till I come, what is that to thee? So John's here saying, Jesus did not say, I will not die till he comes back. That's not what he said. What he said to Peter is, if that's my will, what business is it of yours? This is the disciple which testifieth of these things and wrote these things, and we know that his testimony is true. That is the exact opposite. I have a book in my home written by a textual critic. And what he talks about is how these disciples just perpetuated these fables and myths and made this Jesus who was just a man into the God-man and made up all these stories. That's not what you see here. You see here John saying, you heard this fable, you heard this myth, you heard this story. No, this is not true. I'm telling you, I was there, I heard it myself. So here the writer of the Bible is doing the exact opposite of what the scholars in the ivory towers will tell us today about what the writers of the Bible. He's going for truth and accuracy. Unbelievers will tell you the Bible is all hyperbole and rumor. But John here, in this book, by inspiration of the Holy Spirit, is squelching that rumor. Another proof, your Bible was inspired by God. Because men do hyperbole and rumor. God does not. God operates in truth. Last verse. And there also were many other things which Jesus did, the which, if they should be written every one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that should be written. Amen. And now John is finally done. And that is the truth. The fullness of the Godhead bodily coming to earth, operating according to prophecy, fulfilling every prophecy that was said about him to the T, to what's going to happen with his clothes while he's nailed to a tree. Amazing. And that is the book of John. Done. Any thoughts? No, don't do that.